Hey, Bill Nye, the science guy here.
This is Salman Rushdie.
Hi, this is Julia Sweeney.
I'm Neil deGrasse Tyson.
This is Theo Wilson.
Hi, this is Dar Williams.
I'm Mr. Deity, and you're listening to the Humanist Hour. I command you to listen now, or I will smite you.
I am a sound scientist, came to evaluate the evidence on a closed case, highly classified, confidential, in a race against the clock.
Hey, listeners, thanks for tuning in to the Humanist Hour, the official podcast of the American Humanist Association. I'm your host, Jess Constantine. So this month I'm flying solo because my co-host, Todd Stiefel, is basically being a humanist activist rock star. He's in the middle of a tour, basically, a free thought tour, if you will. So he's currently on his way to Fort Bragg, North Carolina, to speak at Rock Beyond Belief, which is a day of fun and entertainment for the rest of us. So, free event, music, speakers, activism, lots of good stuff happening. You might remember Sergeant Justin Griffith talking about it on our show several months ago. The event's happening. We're excited about it. And you can hear Todd both speak. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, he's also going to be playing a little music with his band. So double dose, good stuff. Last weekend, I was one of nearly 20,000 people to attend the Reason Rally. It was indeed the largest secular gathering in the world. And to this date, it was on the National Mall in Washington, D.C. This was all of the major national and international free thought organizations coming together. So it was sponsored by the American Humanist Association, American Atheists, the Richard Dawkins Foundation, the United Coalition for Reason, or United Core, Center for Inquiry, Stiefel Freethought Foundation, Secular Coalition for America, Secular Student Alliance, Freedom from Religion Foundation, just all the big players were there. And folks, like, what an amazing experience. I mean, we talk about how this movement doesn't feel like a movement sometimes because we're all doing so many different things. We're all just, so it's hard to get us sort of coming together. It's hard to get together people who don't necessarily want to be brought together. And it was the exact opposite experience, just seeing people, hearing people cheer for the things that we all know that we believe in, but just the sheer volume of people. It was quite an experience. So what I want to do is bring some of that experience to you folks. I've got some footage from the Reason Rally. And so I'm going to play pretty much like the first half of it, or highlights from the first half of it. So on today's show, you'll be hearing from Greta Christina, who is a writer and a blogger. She's author of her new book, which is Why Are You Atheists So Angry? 99 Things That Piss Off the Godless. And you're going to hear from Taslima Nasrin, a physician, a writer, a feminist, a human rights activist, and a secular humanist. And finally, we're going to hear from Adam Savage, co-host of Mythbusters, of course. Adam was phenomenal. I have to say, if I had to pick a favorite, it was probably Adam. But don't tell anyone, because they were all great. We're going to hear some music from Tim Minchin, who is a musician, a composer, a songwriter, an actor, and also a comedian, as you'll be able to tell from his songs. And we're going to hear a song from Shelley, who was on our show back in December, and she is the Australian singer-songwriter, and her recent album is called An Atheist Album. So I guess I sort of have a co-host this month because there was an MC at the Reason Rally, and that was Paul Provenza, and he's the host and producer of The Green Room, and that's on Showtime, and he also produced the movie The Aristocrats with Penn Jillette. He was a great host. He was funny. He was informative. He was on point. So you're going to hear some of his intros in between the segments as well. So we're going to hear some footage from the talks and the performances, and also a couple small little exclusive interviews that the Humanist Hour was able to capture backstage. So enjoy the show. Starting us off is my boss, Executive Director of the American Humanist Association, Roy Speckhart.
I'm Roy Speckhart, Executive Director of the American Humanist Association. It was a great experience to look out from the stage at tens of thousands of people who gathered for the Reason Rally. As a movement, we're approaching that tipping point when our voice will be heard and respected, but we need you to get there. Take the next step and become a member. The American Humanist Association has represented the idea that you could be good without a God since 1941. We need your support today to continue our campaigns to reach out to the millions of other non-believers, to lobby Congress on behalf of your progressive values, and to fight for humanist rights in the courts. Visit AmericanHumanist.org to be counted as part of this humanist movement.
say that I need to be saved. Say with me, the devil's got his way. I want to know how when you are praying and when you are doomsdaying, how you think you know. So you think that you can tell us how to live our lives, never questioning the source from which your moral code derives. You think that suffering is part of some great plan that's been devised. I wonder when we'll be rid of your say, I need to hear the truth. A sales pitch of eternal life and eternal youth. All these blessings you are bestowing upon the one you say is all-knowing. Well, are they really deserved? If you're sending me where you say I am going. So you think. Never questioning the source from which your moral code derives. You think that suffering is part of some great plan that's been devised. I wonder, I wonder, I wonder, I wonder, what will it take for you to start opening your eyes, to start questioning the bullshit everyone. You think it's any of your business what goes on between my thighs? I wonder when we'll be rid of your lies. And so you think that you can tell us how to live our lives, never questioning source from which your moral code derives. You think that suffering is part of some great plan that's been devised. I wonder, I wonder, I wonder, I wonder, what will it take for you to start opening your eyes, to start questioning the bullshit everyone. Think it's any of your business what goes on between my thighs. I wonder when we'll be rid of your lies. Of your lies.
Thank you.
That was Shelley Segal, the singer-songwriter from Australia. Learn more about Shelley at her website, shelleysegal.com. That's S-H-E-L-L-E-Y-S-E-G-A-L.com.
Folks, you know her from her brilliant blog, and she is the author of the book 99 Things That Piss Off Atheists. The brilliant, the fearless, the righteous, Greta Christina, ladies and gentlemen.
Hi. Thank you so much for that kind introduction. Thanks to all the organizations and individuals who have worked so hard to make this happen. And thanks to all of you for coming out in the rain and showing each other and the world this wonderful face of happy, inspired atheism. So why are you atheists so angry? I have been asked this question more times than I can remember. I bet most of you have too. But when people ask this question, they never seem to consider that atheists might be angry because we have legitimate things to be angry about. So I want to talk about why so many atheists are angry. Or rather, since I don't presume to speak for all atheists, I want to talk about why I'm angry. I'm angry that according to a recent Gallup poll, only 45% of Americans would vote for an atheist for president. I'm angry that atheists in the United States are frequently denied custody of their children explicitly because of their atheism. I'm angry on behalf of the atheist blogger in Iran who told me that they have to blog anonymously because if they don't, they'll be executed. I'm angry about preachers who tell women to submit to their husbands because it's the will of God, even when those husbands are beating them within an inch of their lives. I'm angry that people are dying of AIDS in Africa and South America because the Catholic Church convinced them that using condoms makes baby Jesus cry. I'm angry that my wife Ingrid and I had to get married 3 times before we finally had a wedding that was legal in our home state. I'm angry that the Catholic Church and the Mormon Church spent millions of dollars getting Proposition 8 passed so that no other same-sex couples could get married in California. I'm angry that our marriage is not recognized in 42 states or even by the federal government because religious bigotry controls how laws get made in this country. I'm angry that the current Dalai Lama said that although he supports tolerance for gay people, he sees homosexual sex as wrong, unwholesome, a bad action, and contrary to Buddhist ethics. I'm angry that the belief in karma and reincarnation gets used as a justification for the caste system in India. I'm angry that people who are born into poverty and despair are told that it's their fault, that they did something bad in a past life and they're being punished for it. I'm angry that sick children suffer and die because their parents believe in faith healing. And I'm angry that in 39 states, these parents are protected from prosecution for child neglect. I'm angry that in Islamic theocracies, women who have sex outside marriage, who date outside their religion, who disobey their male relatives, are executed. I'm angry that people in Africa are being terrorized, tortured, and killed over accusations of witchcraft. Okay, witch hunts are happening in Africa now, not in the Middle Ages, not in the 1600s, today. I'm angry that Rick Santorum is a serious candidate for president. I am angry that this man's religious beliefs have led him to conclude that states can outlaw birth control, that homosexuality should be illegal, that children are better off with a father in prison than being raised by lesbian parents. He's not being laughed off the national stage. He's won 10 primaries. I'm angry about lying for the Lord. I'm angry that the Mormon Church advocates a policy of deception, censorship, and outright dishonesty about their religion. I'm angry that Mormons who have told the truth about their church's history have been excommunicated. And I want to ask Mitt Romney, do you believe in lying for the Lord? And I'm angry that when people run for political office, when people run for office in the United States, it's considered invasive and intolerant to ask about their religious beliefs. You know, if somebody's going to be making decisions about science policy, I want to know if they think the Earth was created 6,000 years ago. If somebody's going to be making decisions about foreign policy, I want to know that the people making decisions about foreign policy, I want to know, do you believe that there has to be violent warfare in Israel to bring about the second coming? And I resent the fact that if I ask these questions, I'll be seen as bigoted. I'm angry about what happened to Galileo. still. I realize it happened in 1633. I'm still mad. I'm angry that when atheists put up billboards saying simply, you can be good without God, people get outraged at how disrespectful we are. I'm angry that when atheists tried to put up a bus sign in Pennsylvania saying simply and entirely the word atheists, the bus company rejected it. I'm angry that we get seen as intolerant and confrontational simply for existing and simply for being open about who we are. I'm angry that I have to know more about their damn religion than they do. I'm angry that in public, taxpayer-paid high schools around the country, atheist students who are trying to organize clubs, something that they are legally allowed to do, are routinely stonewalled by school administrators. I'm angry that in Salt Lake City, Utah, 40% of all homeless teenagers are gay. Most of them kids who have been kicked out by their Mormon families. I'm angry, okay, angry is not the word, I am enraged at priests who rape children and tell them that it's God's will. And I'm angry that the Catholic Church deliberately, repeatedly, for decades, protected these priests. Deliberately kept it a secret. Deliberately placed the church's reputation as a higher priority than children not getting raped. I'm angry about the Holocaust. I'm angry about Israel and Palestine. I'm angry about 9/11. I'm angry about all of this, and I think I'm right to be angry. I think we are all right to be angry. And I want to finish up by saying something really important about all of this atheist anger. Most of it is not about how religious believers treat atheists. It's about how believers treat other believers. It's anger on other people's behalf. Atheists aren't angry because we're selfish or bitter or joyless. Atheists are angry because we have compassion. Atheists are angry because we have a sense of justice. Atheists are angry because we see millions of people being terribly harmed by religion, and our hearts go out to them, and we feel motivated to do something about it. Atheists aren't angry because there's something wrong with us. Atheists are angry because there's something right with us. Thank you. Thank you.
I think I'm in love.
Greta Christina!
Yeah, we are angry about those things. And I'd just like to point out that no atheist ever went on a cross-country shooting spree because no God didn't call to tell him not to. Our next speaker, folks, this woman, please give her your love and your ample respect. She is a freedom fighter in her own country. She has written 32 books in Bengali, which are translated into 25 languages worldwide. Some of the books in English you can get are Revenge, My Girlhood, and Shame. And she has come all the way to be here today from India. Please welcome Taslima Nasrin.
Good day to you. I'm proud to be able to join the Reason Rally in Washington, D.C. I also believe, like you, that we have to continue our fight for secularism, rationalism, and humanism. We have to make the world a better place. I have come from a country where it is legal to punish people for saying God does not exist. I'm not allowed to hurt anybody's religious sentiments, but religious people have the right to attack my non-religious sentiments. Not only that, they have the right to commit violence against me. I was censored, blacklisted, banned, and banished from my homeland because I said, there is no evidence for God's existence, but there are evidences for evolution. And the universe is neither 6,000 years old, nor was it created in 6 days. I also said, Islam is not compatible with human rights, women's rights, secularism, and freedom of expression. And the Quran was not written by someone who had any knowledge of science. And the Quran, like other religious scriptures, is out of time and out of place. And I confessed that I did not need to read any book on atheism or secularism or humanism to be an atheist. I still believe that for the Muslims, the Quran is the best book that can inspire them to becoming an atheist. I said, the Prophet was not a man of good character. Rather, he was a liar, charlatan, sexist, rapist, pedophile, and a killer. I was thrown out of my country because I said, we do not need God to be good, moral, nice, kind, generous, and humane. And we do not need any law based on religion. No Muslim law or Sharia law, no Hindu law, no Christian law, no Jewish law. We need uniform civil code based on equality. I was thrown out of my country because I said women must not be treated like slaves, sexual objects, and childbearing machines. And rape, domestic violence, sexual abuse, dowry murder, female genital mutilation, slave trade, sex trafficking, sexual slavery must end. Because I said this, I had to leave my country 18 years ago, and I have been prevented from returning to my country. You believe it or not, in some countries, people are still living in the dark ages. I want to share my recent experiences with you. A few days ago, there was a Golden Jubilee celebration in my medical college. I could not attend the celebration as I am not allowed to go back to my country. I received the pictures of my classmates who are now renowned physicians. To my surprise, I found almost all my doctor friends are wearing Islamic veils and growing Islamic beards. But many of my friends who studied arts and became poets, writers, and artists are non-believers. I realize that many people study science only to get a good job. Studying science would not help if people do not have a curious and a logical thinking mind. Sometimes I think that humankind is facing an uncertain future. The specter of new kinds of rivalry and conflict looms large. In particular, the conflict is between two different ideas, secularism and fundamentalism. I do not agree with those who think the conflict is between Christianity and Islam, or Judaism and Islam, or between the East and the West. To me, this conflict is basically between rational, logical thinking and irrational, blind faith. To me, this is a conflict between modernism and barbarism. While some strive to go forward, others strive to go backward. This is a conflict between innovation and tradition, between those who value freedom and those who do not. I believe no country can become civilized without criticizing the dogmatic practices of its religion. Without separating state and religion, no state or society can become modern. The truth is, we are allowed to criticize all religions, but not Islam. It is an accepted idea that there should be a limit to freedom of expression. The question of limitation is very much related to criticism of Islam. Should Islam continue to be untouchable? Many Western intellectuals who are enjoying secularism in their own countries are not agreeing to criticize Islamic oppression of women for fear it might hurt the religious sentiments of Muslims. But I ask, should it remain how it is? And should women continue to be stoned to death? Should they continue to be deprived of their rights and freedom? Everywhere in the world, the fear of offending Muslims and the Islamic world has kept Islam away from the type of critical scrutiny applied to other religions. In the West, people are scared of the Muslim fanatics, but at the same time, they do not want to be seen taking a critical stand that might project them as racists or anti-Muslim. Quite a big amount of energy we spend to protect individual Muslims from questioning the unethical social practices of Islam. If we want to help the Islamic world, we must help Islam go through a similar enlightenment process that other religions have gone through by questioning the inhuman, unequal, unscientific, and irrational aspects of religion. There is a popular belief that the Islamic fundamentalists are just a minority and the most Muslims are moderate. How many moderate Muslims have opposed the numerous fatwas that fundamentalists throughout the world have been issued against people? How many moderate Muslims have opposed the heinous acts of cruelty that have been perpetrated against women by fundamentalists? Sometimes I think either moderate or progressive Muslims are in the closet or they do not exist. I have been living without my home, my family, my friends, my society, my country, but I receive support and solidarity from feminists and secular humanists from all over the world. This has made me all the more committed to my cause. I can assure you, I will continue my fight against religious bigotry, fanaticism, and misogyny until my death. Women have been suffering because of anti-women religion, patriarchy, culture, customs, and traditions. I dream of a beautiful world where no woman will be oppressed and where reason will not be replaced with unreason. Today's Reason Rally in the United States of America is successful. I hope there will be Reason Rallies in other countries too. Yeah. 50 years ago, nobody could imagine one day a black man would become an American president. Today, it is hard to imagine a feminist or an atheist would become an American president, but it will happen for sure. I dream of the day when no American president would say, God bless America. I dream of the day when they will proudly declare that they do not believe in God. Yeah. 30,000 people are supposed to be in the rally today. Next time, I hope it would be a million atheists march. Yeah. Here in Washington, D.C. I have no country, no home, but I feel at home when I am with atheists, secularists, and humanists. Thank you all for making me feel at home. Thank you.
Taslima Nasrin. She, as everybody appearing on this stage today, have come out on their own time and great expense and difficulty to be here, all the way from India. It's beautiful. And she summed up so eloquently and fearlessly what I just say in one sentence, which is that I'm tired of playing this global game of my imaginary friend can beat up your imaginary friend.
So I had the privilege of sitting down to talk to Taslima just a little bit more in depth about what her experience was like being in the U.S., being in a place and being at an event where she could speak so openly about being secular and her disbelief in God and being blasphemous and having that be okay.
And you said in your talk that you come from a place where it's not legal to speak about not believing in God. And how does it feel to be able to be here and to be able to speak, knowing that we have a lot of work to do in our country, but just that it's you can speak freely about it?
You know, I came from Bangladesh. There we have laws against blasphemy. So if we say anything against God or religion, then we get punished. I spoke for women's rights and freedom, and I criticized all religions, not only Islam, in Bangladesh and India. I got 3 fatwas from Bangladesh and 5 fatwas from India. So I am enjoying freedom here. So I have been fighting for freedom of expression. And I was banished from one country, but I am fighting to live in another country, neighboring country, India. But there I cannot enjoy my freedom. But when I travel to the West, I enjoy my freedom. But I'm trying to make the society better so that people who are inspired by me in the subcontinent can fight for freedom of expression. Because without criticism of religions, we cannot make the society civilized and secular. We need to separate state and religion. We need to secularize educational system.
Well, thank you for being here, and thank you for doing the work that you do. Thank you for your bravery.
You can learn more about Taslima at her website, TaslimaNasrin.com. TaslimaNasrin.com. Next, we're going to play a couple of songs from Tim Minchin, who is a singer, a writer, and a comedian from Australia. And just a heads up for anyone listening to this with children or anyone not of age, this next segment does have some explicit language.
This is great. Nothing makes me happier than this. We got a lot of young people here today, and that really warms my heart. I got an Alexa writes, my friend and I are high school seniors, and this rally is making us proud to be atheists. Yes, be proud. Don't let a little girl show you up. Be proud. My mom is a staunch believer. I'm a militant atheist. I can't even dream of mom being proud of my atheism. No, that's science. That's science. That's water and electricity. That's science. And somebody says something, there's another hilarious umbrella one. I'll get to that later, because you know why? Because it's time for Mr. Tim Minchin, ladies and gentlemen. Tim Minchin! Is this your first time performing underwater? Wow, Tim... Tim's such a non-believer, he doesn't even believe in shoes.
This is fucking ridiculous. What is wrong with you people? Standing in the rain because you all don't think something similar. This is a song called Confessions. In three movements. And the first movement is entitled Feminism. And it goes out to Rebecca Watson. Even these people can be divided.
I believe that women have the right to walk the streets at night without being afraid for their lives. And I believe a woman has the right to choose what happens to her body without suffering the judgment of the conservative right. And I believe a woman has the right to wear the clothes she likes without being treated like dirt. And I think we men are pathetic, how we seem to use aesthetics as the measure of a woman's worth. I'm ashamed on behalf of my sex for making women feel like objects. Fuck, I love boobs though. I just really love them. Fuck, I love boobs though. I just wanna rub them. They are just so juby, they make me feel groovy. I would rather watch boobs than a movie. Ba-do-be-do-do-do-do-do. I just really love.
Yeah, boobs.
The second movement is entitled Poverty, open bracket, altruism. Closed bracket. I believe that people are entitled to basic human rights, whether they are rich or they're poor. And I believe a world where no children are starving is a world worth fighting for. And I try to remind myself, even when I'm struggling, how incredibly lucky I am. And I don't think it's okay that the luxuries I crave should come at the expense of my fellow man. I'm sure we could do a little more to alleviate the suffering of the poor. Fuck, I love boobs though. I just really love them. I don't really mind if I am behind, below or above them.
they are just so jubbly. They make me feel lovely. I would rather own boobs than a pub. Be-do-be-do-do-do-do-do. I just really love. Huh? What? Yeah, atheist boobs, yeah. Spinal movement is entitled The Environment. I believe the planet that we live in is a living organism and we must treat her carefully. I don't think we can assume we can just go on consuming her resources indefinitely. The Earth's not a bottomless pit. And we can all do our little bit. Fuck, I love boobs though. I just really care for them. They are equally fun when they're 21, octogenarian. They are just so flappy, they make me feel happy. I would rather eat a boob than a bap. I just really love boobs. Evolutionary theory says bosoms are buttock-like protrusions designed to tempt men in situations when they can't get a glimpse of girls' bums. I find such hypotheses dumb. It's like that one that says lipstick is for making your lips look more like the lips of a happy vagina. Since they said that, I can't look my great aunt in the eye. Why do you have to say that? Oh, why? From the first little suck of colostrum to the grope of the nurse in the old people's hostel. We're just fucking monkeys in shoes. And
an umbrella, I just need a towel. There's the man with a towel. Who would have thought that there'd be a small tribute to Whitney Houston at this rally? There's a lot unexpected. She's no longer in pain. Hi! This is fun, I guess. This is sort of fun. I don't want to be here. We don't want to have to be here. It's a pity, really, isn't it? That 300 years after the Enlightenment, we still have to be here having a fucking rally for the obvious. At least that's what I thought. But actually, I had an experience recently that kind of changed my take on a lot of this sort of stuff. And I want to share it to you because I'm not going to be doing some of the more sort of God-bashing stuff that I used to do because this thing happened, right? I'll tell you, because I think you deserve an explanation for why I'm not doing songs about irreligious songs anymore. I'm just enjoying the silence. So what happened? This is what happened, right? True story. This is an entirely true story. I was in Melbourne in Australia, in Victoria, down the southeast of Melbourne. Yeah, Melbourne. Come on. Why, Australians aren't meant to yell when they hear geography they recognise. That's an American habit. Don't yell just because you recognise the geography. No, do. Melbourne. I was in Melbourne and I was doing a gig in a bar, in a small bar, and I was standing there after the gig with a small group of comedians, and I noticed this bloke down the end of the bar, very striking bloke he was. He was about 6'2", one of these kind of Aussie, bronzed Aussie guys, shirt open down to about here, hairless and tanned guy he was. But I also noticed him because hanging around his neck, lying against his tanned, hairless chest on the end of a quite prominent silver chain was a quite prominent silver cross. You know, the kind of cross you might wear if you're a fan of intersections. Or the lowercase letter T. But probably most commonly if you're a fan of the apparatus upon which first century Romans tortured and put to death thieves and Jewish insurgents. Anyway, he was standing there and he was looking at us, and I could tell he wanted to come over to us. He had that look about him. He was very intense. He was on his own. It was slightly weird. And eventually he came over with his torture equipment flapping against his chest, and he said, "G'day, Tim, my name's Sam." His name, it appears, was Sam. And he said, "I'm from Dandenong." Woo! And Dandenong, for those who don't know, is an outer suburb in the hills just outside Melbourne in Victoria in Australia. And eventually he got talking, and he was talking. He was one of those guys who didn't have a very good understanding of personal space, but he was very passionate, and I respect that. But I could tell he wanted to say something, and eventually he said, "I want to say something." So I was right. And he said, I've always wanted to ask you something, because I'm a big fan of your work, and I don't want you to think I'm offended or nothing, because I'm not. But I'm a Christian." That settled that. And he said, "I've always wanted to ask you, because you do a lot of material about God and stuff, but you've never answered for me the fundamental question of why. Why you don't believe in God." And I said, "Well, Sam, I don't believe in God for the same reason that anyone who doesn't believe in a thing doesn't believe in it, because I haven't yet been offered enough evidence to allay my doubts." And he said, "But you don't just go through your whole life only believing things that you got evidence for, do you?" And I said, "Yep." Yeah, that's pretty much how thus far I've managed to wade my way through my tepid existence, yeah. And he said, "What about love?" And I said, "What about love?" And he said, "Do you believe in love?" And I said, "Yeah, I think so, Sam. Yeah, I believe in love. I feel love. I feel loved. Yeah, I believe in love." And he said, "Aha! You don't have any evidence for love." And I said, "Oh, well, yeah, sure. Love without evidence is stalking, Sam." So it was going fine, right? And then Sam said this. He told me the story of his mum, an incredible story, and I'll tell you it now as quickly as I can. Apparently Sam's mum in her early 60s had developed a problem with her eyes, and she didn't want to go to the doctor. She didn't like the idea of doctors, but eventually they cajoled her into going. And the GP, the MD, took one look at her eye and said, "You must see a specialist as soon as possible. This is a degenerative eye disorder. If you don't have surgery, you will go blind." And Sam's mum was afraid because she didn't trust doctors. She didn't believe in modern medicine. But Sam and his mum had their church there in the hills, in the Dandenong Ranges outside Melbourne in Victoria in Australia. There was one of these big glass, really popular churches. And it was to their church that they went that Sunday. And apparently the entire packed congregation of some 3,000 people all simultaneously prayed for Sam's mum. And the following Tuesday, when they went to the specialist, there was no sign whatsoever that there'd been anything wrong with her eyes. They were perfectly healthy. She was cured. She'd been healed. And the reason this story had such an impact on me as I try more than anything else to be intellectually honest, you know, with myself and with others. And all I've ever said is I want evidence. And here I was for the first time experiencing a first-person account of what can only be described as a miracle. So I went right on home and I wrote this song. Have an apology to make. I'm afraid I've made a big mistake. I turn my face away from you, Lord. I was
was too blind to see the light. I was too meek to feel your might. I closed my eyes, I couldn't see the truth, Lord. But then like Saul on the Damascus Road, you sent a messenger to me, and so now I've had the truth revealed to me. Please forgive me all those things I said. I'll no longer betray you, Lord. I will pray to you instead, and I will say thank you, thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you, thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for fixing the cataracts of Sam's mum. I had no idea, but it's suddenly so clear. Now I feel such a cynic. How could I have been so dumb? Thank you for displaying how praying works. A particular prayer in a particular church. Thank you, Sam, for the chance to acknowledge this omnipotent ophthalmologist. Thank you, God, for fixing the cataracts of Sam's mum. I didn't realize that it was so simple, but you've shown a great example of just how it can be done. You only need to pray in a particular spot to a particular version of a particular God. And if you pull that off without a hitch, he will fix one eye of one middle-class white bitch. I know in the past my outlook has been limited. I couldn't see examples of where life had been definitive, but I can admit it when the evidence is clear as Sam's mum's new cornea. And that's extremely clear. Thank you, God, for fixing the cataracts of Sam's mum. I have to admit that in the past I have been skeptical, but Sam described this miracle and I am overcome. How fitting that the sighting of a sight-based intervention should open my eyes to this exciting new dimension. It's like someone put an eye chart up in front of me and the top five letters say ICGOD. Thank you, Sam, for showing how my point of view has been so flawed. I assume there was no God at all, but now I see that's cynical. It's simply that his interests aren't particularly broad. He's largely undiverted by the starving masses or the inequality between the various classes. He gives out strictly limited passes, redeemable for surgery or two-for-one glasses. I feel so shocking for historically mocking you. Your interests are clearly confined to the ocular. I bet given the chance you'd eschew the divine and start a little business selling contacts online. Fuck me, Sam, what are the odds that of history's endless parade of gods, that the God you just happen to be taught to believe in is the actual one? And he digs on healing, but not the AIDS-ridden African nations, nor the victims of the plague, nor the flat-addled Asians, but healthy, privately insured Australians with common and curable lens degeneration. The story of Sam's has but a single explanation. A surgical god who digs on magic operations. No, it couldn't be mistaken. Attribution of causation. Born of a coincidental temporal correlation. Exacerbated by a general lack of education. Vis-a-vis physics in Sam's parish congregation. It couldn't be that all these pious people are liars. It couldn't be an artifact of confirmation bias. Or a product of groupthink. A mass delusion. An emperor's new clothes style fear of exclusion. No, it's more likely to be an all-powerful magician than the misdiagnosis of the initial condition. Or one of many cases of spontaneous remission, or a record-keeping glitch by the local physician. They're the only explanation for Sam's mum seeing. They prayed to an all-knowing super being, to the omnipresent master of the universe, and he liked the sound of their muttered verse. So for a bit of a change from his usual stunt of being a sexist, racist, murderous, he popped down to Dandenong and just like that used his powers to heal the cataracts of Sam's mum. Sing the cataracts of Sam's mum. I didn't realize that it was such a simple thing. I feel such a ding-a-ling, what ignorant scum. Now I understand how prayer can work. A particular prayer in a particular church, in a particular style, with a particular stuff, and for particular problems that aren't particularly tough, and for particular people, preferably white, and for particular senses, preferably sight. A particular prayer in a particular spot to a particular version of a particular God. And if you get that right, he just might take a break from giving babies malaria and pop down to your local area to fix the cataracts of your mum.
That was Tim Minchin. You can learn more about him at his website, timminchin.com. TimMinchin.com. We're going to round today's show out with Adam Savage, co-host of the show Mythbusters. As I said earlier, I really enjoyed Adam's talk. I believe it really sort of fully encompassed the ideals of humanism. So here it is.
I play a scientist on TV. I am in awe of those that do it for real. Testable, provable phenomena. And the predictions they allow, big and small, brought me here in front of you today. And they will take me back to my family when I am done. They allowed me to drive to DC on a bus, type my speech on a screen, ride to this rally in a car, walk on shoes that support my feet, and wear clothes and a hat that protects my pale skin from the sun. To fly on a plane home. That plane I will get on exists and stays in the air because of a million large and tiny tested predictions about lift, drag, material performance, physics, electricity, radio waves, wear, tear, shear, checklists, human error, machine error, and redundancy. It is a miracle of engineering. It is the result of an ancient and very human drive, a drive that makes us what we are, in all of our unique specialization, a drive to solve problems. Many tens of thousands of people combined their collective genius to make an impossibly fast and efficient, thin, inflated bubble of aluminum so stable and secure that you'd have to fly for several thousand years before the odds gave you an even chance of being in an accident. Everything that we have that makes our lives possible exists because human beings have tested the things they found in their surroundings, made predictions based on those tests, and then improved upon them. This is reason, the human capacity to make sense of the world. Here are some other things that, like the components of the airplane, have been tested and proven. I'm going to call them facts. E equals MC fucking squared. Force equals mass times acceleration. The Earth is not the center of the universe. Man landed on the moon in 1969 and a few times thereafter. Burning airplane fuel caused a tragic, catastrophic collapse of the Twin Towers in 2001. The Earth is spherical. Well, not precisely round. It is officially slightly pear-shaped. Human industry is causing a significant rise in the Earth's overall temperature. The Earth is over 4 billion years old. Evolution is literally a fact of life. As Neil deGrasse Tyson says, facts are true whether or not you believe them. Now, here are some of my beliefs that are true to me. You cannot teach kids about sex by telling them not to have it. I believe that making drugs illegal is stupid and damaging to us as a people. I believe that if we take care of our surroundings, they will take care of us. I believe that inside every tool is a hammer. I believe that people have an inalienable right to choose what to do with their own bodies. I believe that in a community, it is our duty that we should take care of each other in times of need. I believe that if you tell people the truth and let them make decisions based on that, much of the time they'll make pretty good decisions, but not always. I believe that that which is detestable to you, you should not do to another. I believe that while not all people are essentially good, most are trying. I believe that rules do not make us moral. Loving each other makes us moral. And finally,
I have concluded through careful empirical analysis and much thought that somebody is looking out for me, keeping track of what I think about things, forgiving me when I do less than I ought, giving me strength to shoot for more than I think I'm capable of. I believe they know everything that I do and think, and they still love me, and I've concluded after careful consideration that this person keeping score is me. Thank you.
Mr. Adam Savage. Adam Savage. Wow. Boy, is this a special day. This is probably the only day in history where you could get a Bruce Springsteen-sized cheer just for saying the Earth is over 4 billion years old.
That was great. Man, that, what an inspiring speech that was. I wish he had blown something up, though. I guess that's probably not a good thing to do on the Washington Mall.
That was Adam Savage, co-host of the show Mythbusters, where Adam and his co-host prove and disprove urban legends by experimenting with them. You can learn more about Adam at his website, adamsavage.com. You can learn more about Mythbusters at the Discovery Channel website, discovery.com. So I also had the opportunity just to snag Adam and just ask a couple questions about his thoughts on the day, and I asked if there was ever going to be an episode on that one urban legend that we all agree upon.
Adam Savage, thanks for being part of the Reason Rally, largest free thought event in the world. What's your thoughts on this event?
It's lovely. You know, one of the things I've always thought about atheists is that they really should get together every Sunday and talk about it. I think community and a sense of deep seated community is something that the religious have always had over atheists, because it is a very powerful mechanism and it shouldn't be ignored. And so to come out here with a crowd like this in the pouring rain and hear the responses that I heard personally and I'm hearing from other speakers is thrilling.
So you're from Mythbusters. Have you ever done a show on God?
No, you know, the religious looking for Bigfoot, the Loch Ness Monster, religious miracles, even divining and other things like that, it all falls into the category of what James Randi would call woo-woo. We call it oogie boogie. And you find yourself in the unenviable position of trying to prove a negative, which to a scientist, which is really what we are doing on television, is impossible. You can't go looking for something and then when you don't find it, go, well, it doesn't exist. That's actually not scientific. But until there's compelling evidence that it does exist, there's no reason for us to go near it. And there isn't any compelling evidence. So to us, until we have something like that we can use as a control that we can test against, we stay away from material that doesn't have that.
Thanks so much for speaking with the Humanist Hour.
Well, folks, there you have it. Adam Savage, co-host of the show The Mythbusters. Hope that you enjoyed our show for this month. I hope that you feel like you're at the Reason Rally. Of course, you got to stay dry, which is good. Next month, we'll be playing the rest of the content. So more scientists, more representatives from other free thought organizations, more comedians, and more music. To learn more about the guests from this month's show, you can visit thehumanisthour.org. While you're there, subscribe to our podcast on iTunes or via RSS. Like us on Facebook and give our listener comment line a call, 202-618-1371. If you are at the Reason Rally, we want to hear from you. What'd you think? Who'd you like? You can also access our podcast episode archives at thehumanisthour.org. And now you can find us on Pathos at pathos.com/blogs/thehumanisthour. Other things to check out online are the AHA Annual Conference. You can learn more about that at conference.americanhumanist.org. That's this June 7th through 10th in New Orleans. I can't wait, folks. And actually, Shelley Segal, who you heard earlier in this episode, will be performing live there as well. If you're in the North Carolina area this weekend, last weekend in March, you should definitely check out Rock Beyond Belief. Get more information at rockbeyondbelief.com. Folks, thanks for listening to The Humanist Hour. I'm your host, Jess Constantine, and my co-host, Todd Stiefel, will be back with me next month.
My morality has nothing to do with the Bible or the verses of the Quran.
my morality. Won't judge you by your spirituality, but by the things that you have done. My morality is not set into stone tablets. Who don't even tell you not to hurt children. My morality is not dictated by a deity. It's developed from empathy, dependence, and love. My morality accepts everybody's sexuality, is more concerned with inequality than validations from above. My morality is not set into stone tablets, who don't even tell you that it's worthwhile to be good for being good's own sake, that not to think for yourself can be a deadly mistake. My morality is not recitable from memory. It's something inside of me, how I want to be. Treat others how I want them to treat me. Basically, not to hurt anybody. Abhors any brutality. It stems from our common humanity. It's what my father taught to me. And it's mine because I'm free.
Thank you.